All righty, before we get started, for those of you who followed any of our BBIP work, you know I love to start our gatherings with the St. Francis prayer, so we're going to do that tonight. Susan's going to keep letting people in for me.
Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, where there is doubt.
Oh, I just love that. Feels a bit like a reunion. Let me do some extra welcomes. Hey, Sharon and Michael, nice to see you. Hope your eyes recovering well. Hi, Janae, Gabby, Deborah, and whoever's on the phone. It's nice to have you with us. Ah, so let's all take a deep. It is. Hey, Jody, good to see you, my friend. So let's all take a deep breath together. And just truly be here in the wonder that none of us have a clue what's really going to happen. And that, in and of itself, is a great expression of freedom. So we're coming together at the request of my friend Susan, who I spend a lot of time with, and we love and celebrate claiming freedom together. And she shared that a lot of what I share with her, kind of about some of the other Christ consciousness pathways that I and many of you have touched, relate to the Lama Sing work, which is kind of Susan's pathway, and how we often pick up ideas, concepts, beliefs, practices from spiritual pathways. And sometimes we hold on to them a little too long. They are helpmates initially, and then we can find ourselves a little stuck in them. So how we can cultivate a fertile ground for freedom rather than a fertile ground that continues to perpetuate our journey of seeking. So that's kind of why we've come together tonight. Susan, does that encapsulate it? Anything you'd like to add?
Oh, I think that's great.
So, really, it's going to be interactive. I don't have anything planned or prepared. If nobody has a question to get us started, I can just kind of give an example and we'll go from there. But if you do, use the raise hand button and Susan's going to manage kind of who's up next.
Okay, Donald has a question.
Make sure to unmute yourself, Donald.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
This has to do with a message from Christ and a love story from Al. It was one of the first readings on here. And it was, let's see, I printed it out. It was right in the very beginning there in italics. When he smiled beautifully as an old friend might, and I heard him say to me, "Did you free your spirit?" And could you put some words around that or some thing about more precisely what that meant?
Sure. I'll see if Susan wants to add any context about that particular reading before I jump into why Jesus might have asked Al that question.
No, go ahead, John.
Okay. So I don't remember the fullness of that reading, but at any time that Jesus might address any of us and say, "Have you freed your spirit?" What might that mean to you? At least what arises within you?
Are you talking to me specifically? Or
no, I'm just kind of addressing everyone. So what John, Jesus is pointing at, yeah, Susan.
What is the date of that, Donald? Do you know what the date of that reading is?
It was actually the first reading on the thing about this group. Let me see.
I can find it. I don't suppose it really matters specifically the date, but it's interesting that, Al had been doing that work and had been living his life in that essence of freedom for decades.
Go ahead.
And so it's an interesting question to pose to him. Have you freed your spirit?
Well, I think it was around December, maybe the last year Al was alive. It was kind of toward the end of his life, I think, rather than the beginning, when he was doing his work. But I don't see the date off of that.
I think it was in 2001, so there were still 17 years to go. But he had been doing this work for a very, very long time. Mm-hmm. So, thank you, Donald. That's a great question. Go for it, John Mark.
All right. So we'll get to the essence of it. So in many of Jesus's pathways, he says, begin at the beginning. And really, that's what he was asking Al. Have you freed your spirit? Because our spirits in their creation, and each of us absolutely unique as a creation of God, our spirits were utterly, radically free. No conditions, no requirements, no obligations, no responsibilities, no nothing. Just radically, utterly free potentials of consciousness. So when Jesus might ask Al or any of us, have you freed your spirit? Well, it was just a question allowing everyone to reflect within, am I truly free? Or am I carrying within my being limits? Am I carrying obligations, boundaries, responsibilities, things that I should be doing, must be doing, that we have learned and picked up along the way? So am I limiting myself by my own beliefs, by my own structures, by my own relationship to memories, whatever the case may be? So he's asking, have you freed yourself? Which is a very important and relevant question. And because oftentimes we do not live our lives and originate from our primordial state of freedom. Rather, we operate from a self-induced, we can call it dream or sleepiness or illusion or whatever the case may be. We're operating within a self-structure of limits. And then we set up the what Jesus would call the greatest illusion, the illusion of time, in order to try and free ourselves from that and return to a state of freedom. So Jesus didn't ask him, hey, have you done all your spiritual practices today? Have you done all this? Have you done all that? Just have you freed yourself? Because that's the simple truth. No one can free us. We can free ourselves. We have the power because only we have the power to limit ourselves. And by incarnating in the earth, we all made that choice. Think, decide whatever you will about that choice. We all made that choice together. So Donald, I really think that's what Jesus was asking, Alan would ask any of us. Are you claiming and being the fullness that God created you to be as an unlimited spiritual being? Or are you claiming self in some significantly lesser way?
Thank you.
Because really, as any good teacher, and he's the master of all teachers, will meet the student where the student is at. So if he's inviting Al to claim his freedom, he and Al claims his freedom, then the master can join him at freedom, and that's a whole different place than, well, I'm claiming I got all these problems and I got all this stuff I need to fix. Well, then the teacher will try and help the student from that point of view. Does that make sense? So we return to the beginning. We return to the unchanging and unchangeable, unlimited nature of our unique spiritual beings. And then we move forward from that.
And the interesting part of that to me also is that he wasn't indicating that Al hadn't, but in that question, he was drawing Al's attention to that. Like after decades of that work, to be asked that question. I mean, you know, that's a pretty interesting question for any of us to ask ourselves at this point in our tenure.
Mm-hmm. And even service to others can be a limit. Anything can limit us that we hold on to that limits our freedom. So it's a wonderful question, and one that is worthy of asking oneself on a regular basis. Am I coming from a state of freedom and limitlessness and the nature of my eternal being, or am I coming from something significantly less, hoping I'll get there in the future? So good question, Donald. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was great.
Kelly?
In our group gathering today, one of the things that came up, and this is a perfect segue, was question of, is there a universal law that you need to see, understand your blockages? And it's so tricky because we can spend lifetimes exploring blockages. So I'm just wondering if there's a universal law around that, or if that's been part of the quote unquote spiritual ego, is like, I need to continue to discover limitations, discover limitations, discover limitations to then let them go. So I'm just curious about that.
Sure. Well, let's be clear that Lama Singh identifies universal law as the sovereignty of any and every being uniquely to exercise their free will. That's universal law, is that every soul in existence, every spirit in existence has free will, and they can use it however they wish. And universal law protects that right. Every one of us has the power to choose, and we get to use it individually, however we do it, from different menu items in a restaurant to pathways that we choose to follow, right? So many spiritual thought systems that have arisen have taken on the idea of, you have got to do this, you have got to look at this, you have got to do these practices, you've got to investigate this way, you've got, And those are not universal law, because within true universal law, just as Jesus asked Al, have you set yourself free? We all have the power to set ourselves free. The real question is, am I willing to accept that I have that power and manifest the effect of that choice? Or do I not believe that I can do that? Therefore, I need practice. I need to take steps. I need to have it be a process, so to speak. So that's really a very individual thing, but it is not a universal law. There is a lot of energy out there behind people who have adopted that thing. I have to find all these blocks. And because that's been their journey, they project that requirement onto everybody else and then make it the way, not their chosen or required way. And if you remember in the Way of Mastery, Jesus talks about, may you choose a way that is full of joy, right? Because he's invited, because we're all creating our journey as we go. And this idea that we have to conform to one specific universal requirement and get it right, all of that is stuff that has come within mass mind and finiteness. It was all probably well intended when it was created, but then it can become a profoundly limiting thing. So all of us early in our journey, we're carrying guilt or shame or unworthiness or lots of that kind of stuff, right? And probably none of us were anywhere close to being willing to claim the power to let all that go in kind of one fell swoop. So symbols like forgiveness can be a very helpful tool at parts of our journey where we can let ourselves go, set ourselves free from past guilt or past memories or shames or whatever we've judged about ourselves and others. But like with anything else, that can also become a burden, because then we take that on as a requirement. So then we actively engage in it more and more and more and more. And when I realized I was done with forgiveness, I realized my mind had accepted forgiveness as a purpose so much so that it was actually making shit up from past lives to forgive. Do you see my point? And this is a really important thing for any of us to look at, because the mind, if it takes on a thought system, if it takes on a belief structure, if it takes on a requirement, it will literally attempt to manifest that because it wants what it believes the results of that will be. Not yet understanding that continuing to pursue fixing oneself or looking for blocks is actually a perpetuation of that which limits, not a claim of freedom. So in an overriding sense, universal law is the free will of all children of God to express that free will as they wish. So if there's something within your being that needs to be released, is it a simple look and a choice? Or does it have to be a process? Does it have to include meditation and breathing and lots of other stuff? Each of us uniquely impose those requirements. Those are not universal laws, not universal requirements. Before I get to you, Donald, does that answer it, Kelly, or is there any follow-up to that? Okay, thumbs up and balloons. I love that. We're rising, letting go of. And by the way, I just love the graphic that Susan made up of us throwing ballasts off. I love that symbol of a hot air balloon. All you have to do is toss the stuff over the side and you naturally rise. We just toss the weight off the side. So back to Kelly's question, well, what's the law about how long you have to hold that piece of ballast before you throw it over? Or can you just toss it? I would advocate just toss it. We don't need to open the bag up and investigate every little crumb that's in there unless you really want to. That's just going to take you longer to rise, or you can just toss it.
So this gets into addressing what I call a lifelong burden. I was born and raised in a conservative Christian background, and you know, the whole thing is pounded into, and that is unless you're saved, you're going to hell. And we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God, and he died for our sins. And I knew what thoughts were going through my mind, what feelings I had that just didn't kind of G up the proposed belief system. And I think it's a weight that is carried by a lot of people, but I can speak for myself. And, you know, I went through the path and I, you know, did the walk the walk, supposedly. And when I was in college, I was president of the University Christian Fellowship on campus. About halfway through my tenure, I said, wait a minute. And just like the guy before me, went through the same process. And when they put me in as president, they thought they had a sure thing and that wouldn't happen to them again. Well, that wasn't true. And, but I couldn't walk away from the thing guilt-free, if you can understand that. And it was tough sledding, and I emotionally, mentally, spiritually, whatever. But anyway, here I am trying to cast some of this stuff off of this blimp, and it's great. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, the distortion of Jesus's life and the distortion of the teachings around his life and his ministry and the gifts that he truly came to offer, that is a rich field for forgiveness in a lot of ways. There's a rich opportunity to set ourselves free. I mean, my favorite was he was the Son of God and the rest of us are chopped liver, you know, and we could never be like him. And of course, he didn't say to Al, hey, would you like for me to be the savior of your spirit? No, he asked Al to use his power. Have you set your spirit free? Because God set it free in our creation, because God literally is freedom. So rich, rich opportunities to let lots and lots of that stuff go. Now, I'm an advocate, if you do have forgiveness or you do need to let things go or you do like process, I like Sam's Club forgiveness, where you do it in bulk. So rather than like, look, for me, I'll give an example. I was trying to forgive relationships, one relationship at a time. Well, why not just forgive all relationships at the same time? You see what I mean? Instead of buying one soda, I can buy, you know, a whole pack at Sam's Club. So expanding the power of that forgiveness to reduce process and time. So I'll throw that out there. But to Donald's point, there is an awful lot in mass mind about Jesus, about God, whether it's in our culture or other cultures, that is profoundly distorted and frankly very, very frightening. So setting oneself free from all that is sometimes no small task, but it need not be hard, need not take a long time. Unless you insist that it does, then take all the time you want. Anyone else? So while if no one else has a question, I'll share this. Think of spiritual practices, no matter who suggests them to you, no matter what purpose you believe they serve, no matter what benefit you believe you're going to get out of them, always think of them as temporary stepping stones. Don't become so devoted to them. It's kind of like if you break your leg, crutches are really helpful. So spiritual practices can be really helpful in times of healing. But once your leg is healed, continuing to walk on the crutches only serves to limit. And the same thing can happen with teachings, whether that teaching is self-inquiry or some physical body breath modality or energetic modality or whatever the case may be. They're all double-edged swords. They can all be really helpful. But if we cling to them and become needy of them, or devoted to them in a way that can become a limit. So you can just ask yourself, have I got any stuff that were crutches that were helpful early in my journey that maybe I can set those crutches down? Maybe I can set that practice down. And I'll give just an example, since nobody else has raised their hand and I'm trying to fill some time. So in the Course in Miracles, Jesus says, your only purpose here is forgiveness. And a lot of people interpret that to be here meaning earth, and forgiveness meaning I'm forgiving whatever I see that disturbs me, right? I'm forgiving a judgment. So they can orient themselves to always needing to judge something in order to fulfill their purpose of forgiving. So we don't realize sometimes we can take on those distortions when to forgive is really to set oneself free. That's a very different thing than looking out at a world trying to forgive everything that disturbs you, rather than looking out on a world to set yourself free from. Those are very, very different things, and they'll have very, very different outcomes. But inevitably, when we hear spiritual teachings early in our journeys, we take them quite literally through the definitions that we have learned in life. And oftentimes, the spiritual meaning of those same words is really, really different than how we've learned to define them on the earth. And as a result, they can manifest in really different ways within us.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Shanae? You'll need to unmute, my friend.
There we go. Hi.
It's nice to see you. Tell Roderick it's really I said nice hello too.
I will, for sure. I've been toying with some words from Way of Mastery that I read recently about how we must, or to really be free, one needs to fully embrace illusion, as well as fully embrace freedom. And I wonder if you wouldn't mind talking about fully embracing illusions.
Sure. Good question. So where do illusions come from?
Are you asking me personally?
Well, if you want to add. If not, it's just kind of a rhetorical question for everyone.
Okay, I'll take it on. Ideas in the mind, projections from the mind, ego mind.
So where does ego mind come from?
Let's make that rhetorical for everybody to consider.
Okay. All right. So here we go. So consider for a moment that God as creator created all beings in God's image, meaning all of us are creators. So we are all free and limitless creators. But we have all created profoundly limiting experiences. We've all created bodies, which we mistake as ourself, that seems to represent a very distinctly and constantly needy being, right? I mean, the body is a ceaseless need machine. Our spirit has no needs. It's always whole, always full, always complete. So when Jesus is suggesting the Way of Mastery, we must first embrace illusion, he's really inviting us to claim our creative power with which we have created illusion. Because if we do not claim that I have done this to myself, I've created in a way that has created a very limited experience, we will be dismissing the very power of freedom that we were given by God. So needing to claim all of our creations, because everything that's happened on the earth, as illusory as it may be, all the pain that we've suffered, illusory as it may be, is a creation. And if we dismiss them, we're dismissing the power and the freedom with which they can all be created. Because God doesn't place any limits on the children of God. We can create, and just look at this world. We've created some wonderfully terrible things. Nuclear weapons, famine, incredible diseases. I mean, all of that stuff. Because if you don't claim that, accept it, and embrace it, it's very easy to stay in some sense of judgment about it and standoffish. And that can get really subtle when you try to set yourself free of it to judge those who might still be creating in those limiting ways, rather than recognizing your freedom to not create that way and others' freedoms to continue to create that way. Does it make sense? So any creation that we seek to dismiss and ignore and throw out, and I'm be very clear here, I'm not talking about indulging illusions either, because we've all fallen down that spiritual hole. It's about embracing all of creation, whether it's illusory or not, because all of it is the effect of the creative power of the children of God, uniquely and collectively. So that's why he's asking us to embrace illusion, because when we do, we'll realize there's a ton of truth, there's a ton of creative power and freedom in the illusion. Make sense?
Yeah, and goes right along with what else he says, which is give everybody else complete freedom to create the way they create.
Indeed. Yeah, let them, universal law, let them exercise their free will however they wish. Believe whatever they wish, create whatever they wish. I mean, if you want to be free, free everyone else. As within, so without. It's a pretty simple thing. Unless, of course, you need to forgive everything out there, and then you've kind of interrupted that simplicity and made it really complicated.
In which case, you just create making it really hard.
That's right. We've all done that, too. I'll confess to making some parts of my journey really challenging and difficult.
Thank
Joan,
you.
You're welcome. Good question, my friend.
Am I up now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. I kind of wanted to go back to the crutches that you talked about before Janae was speaking. And I guess I just see a caution for myself. And it's because a lot of times we might throw away our current crutches, but then we go and we find something else on the spiritual smorgasbord and we go with that, you know, and it's a new set of crutches. That's all it is. Yeah. And so, you know, I know myself, I have to rely on some really self-honesty, you know, to the nth degree to say, really, is this helping me? Or am I stuck in something? Or am I relying on this, to recognize the crutches when they're there? So, I was wondering if you could say more about that.
Sure. It's a very, very good question and a really important one. We all take on things that we believe will be helpful for us. Because of the way we were born into the earth, having forgotten our spiritual neighbor, nature, having forgotten who and what we truly are, we have this kind of mind that is a blank slate. So fundamental in that is this belief that reality is a constant state of learning. And, you know, from the time we're first begin to be educated, what is reinforced in all beings is, I have to learn more. 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 And this belief that if I learn more, well, then maybe I'll be more powerful, or I'll be more skillful, or I'll know more, and then I'll know what to do to be okay or safe, or I'll know how to make money, or whatever the case may be. So that tendency, that arc of trying to consume more information is birthed in all of us because of the forgetful nature of incarnating on earth. And it's a stretch to say, wait a minute, if it's known in God, who's all-knowing, then it's known in me. And what if I was willing to claim that and open to that? Could all knowledge that's necessary flow through me without me having to, quote, have learned it or mastered it or become an expert in the information. So that arc of I need to get more info can often be carried very deep into our spiritual journey. I've heard Kelly use the term fear of missing out. Sometimes that even activates us to pick up a new set of crutches or a new technique or a new book or a new something. And inevitably, there's juicy mind stuff in there. There are new ideas, there are new concepts. But recognize that if we constantly chase from that finite, not knowing mind, we're not using that time and energy to claim oneness with the all-knowing consciousness. Make sense? So I'm not making modalities or spiritual pathways or spiritual, I'm not making any of that wrong. I'm just inviting all of us to recognize, hey, is it time to set something down? Is it time that something was useful? And I've talked to a couple of you here, like you had some techniques that were really well to change your state of being at some point, and then they all just stopped working. And you're like, what the fuck? I mean, come on, this used to work to make me feel better, and now reciting Course in Miracle lessons in my mind doesn't seem to be changing anything. Well, those are indications that it's time to kind of set that thing down and move on. So the question that you might ask yourself, Joan, or any of us, why do I feel drawn to this? Is it an expression of my freedom because it will enhance my joy? Or is it because I think there's something there that I need that I don't have? Because if it's arising from that level of need and emptiness and gotta getness, that's really arising from an illusory sense. If it is a sense of I'm an unlimited being and there's infinite potentials out here and I can play and explore and discover, and that's a very different, that's approaching something from a state of freedom, not needing to get, but welcoming the experiences to expand your creative being, right? So we can always, do I feel a need for this? Or is this an opportunity for me to be in joyful expression? That's kind of a little litmus test that can sometimes be helpful.
You said something during your talking that I found extremely helpful because it was all helpful, but one point was you said that you receive the knowledge that is necessary for you. This is an important point for me because I often hear, you know, we are one with God and all knowledge is ours, and it's like, well, I'm so far from having all knowledge, it gets my mind thinking about knowledge, like, okay, I'm going to understand quantum physics, or I'm going to understand Wall Street interactions, whatever. And it's like, no, but having the knowledge that is necessary, that is the big point. Thank you for that. Yeah. Because,
well, let's expand on that a little bit, because this is a juicy one, right? Because finite mind thinks all knowing is knowing all facts and figures, knowing all finite form-based details. Mm-hmm. What if being all knowing is never forgetting who and what you are and being in creative, responsive relationship with life? Not knowing infinite details of information. Did Jesus know everything? I mean, did he one day say, finally, I've incarnated a million times, I've gone to every potential school, I know every fact and figure in existence? No, but he didn't. He always knew who and what he was in oneness with the source. So all knowledge and wisdom was available to him when he needed it. Now, just feel for a moment the freedom in your own mind of letting this idea of needing to be all knowing to be all receiving of what knowledge I need in any given moment. Nothing for the mind to do but to be open and spacious that it might be infilled. And this is Jesus's whole parable about your cup runneth over kind of thing. Mm-hmm. That you haven't filled your cup with your own stuff, And by the way, I mean, has anybody ever considered how long it might take to know all facts and figures? I mean, clearly, just let's give up. Let's stop. I mean, that's crazy. That would never work. And if you can actually let your mind be set free from that belief and that pursuit, it will naturally come into a state of ease and spaciousness, where then what I call gnosis, or what you might call intuition, will naturally arise. And look at our lives. Do we need to know quantum physics? Do we need to know a historical accurate event from 4 centuries ago? We need to know, look both ways before you cross the road. I mean, it's much, much simpler. So all knowing is all nowing, really, of who and what I am in oneness, not a mental thing of all data available. Oh my God, I mean, what a relief. Because, I mean, just, I mean, all of us, I think, would honestly admit, this little mind could never do that. I mean, I recognize I can't remember somebody's phone number for 5 minutes. Why would I think I could learn all information in my little finite mind? Ay, ay, ay. So nice add-on, Joan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sharon, you're up. And Deborah, you're on deck.
I got so wrapped up with what you were saying, I forgot I even had my hand raised. John Mark, ever since I can remember as a child, the concept of sin has always bewildered me, and yet it's become such a thing with a mass mind. Could you talk a little bit about the concept of sin and how it's come to affect us as a society and as a mass mind and religion?
Well, there's I don't know how many people we have here, 36 people who all have their own unique version of how they've suffered by their own sins and the sins of others. But what if sin is simply self-judgment? I mean, there's no sin because there's really no right or wrong. So again, since we've been taught in that empty little mind that we birthed ourselves into, everything was put in two categories, right and wrong. And when it was right, most of the time we got rewarded. When it was wrong, we often got punishments. There was this great incentive to not get it wrong or not sin and try and get it right. And none of us have managed to figure out that mysterious perfect formula. Is there anyone here who has? If so, I'd really like to give you the talking stick and just sit back and listen. So sin in mass mind is used as an incredibly harsh means to limit self and limit others. Because again, God giving only freedom, what choice is not okay? I mean, our choices will create experiences, and you can, you know, if you choose to harm someone physically, or you choose to rob a bank, there are consequences. There are experiences that will be the effect of that. That's just cause and effect. So every cause has its effect. And you know what? Our effects are powerful teachers. They tell us whether I'm going to do that again or not, right? So rather than it being I've sinned, what if it's I've created and I've learned? And I'm going to grow from that and not do that again. Make sense? So sin has this component of guilt attached to it. And by the way, while we're on the thing of sin, we can go ahead and throw that Jesus came to save us because we were all born in sin. We were all so bad. He came and took on all the sins of everybody's sins, and he suffered as a result. I mean, that's profoundly guilt-inducing, right? What he came to show was that even if the illusory world does what it does and attacks you and blah, 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 he came to just demonstrate, hey, you'll always exist. There's eternal life. There is no judgment. There is no end. There is no ceasing to exist. Set yourself free from all of those sins or misperceptions, if you will. I mean, this is a deep well and can go subtly, because it's in so many, many things. I mean, I know we've all felt that incredible icky feeling within when we believe we've done nothing, but someone else thinks we have done something wrong, right? And we take on their projection or their judgment of us. And now we're in a world of self-created, not feeling so good about it. So the relationship to sin is really to let it go, but let your experiences be teachers for you, because you'll never lose the ability to choose. You'll never lose the ability to experience. There's not a right way to do it. There's not a wrong way to do it. There's only a free way to do it. And the more you become conscious of that, the more you will create experiences that you really prefer and enjoy. And likewise, you'll give the other people freedom to create those. So, yeah, the thing, it's best just to throw out the whole thing about sin. If you're a Course in Miracles student, there's actually a Course in Miracle lessons which says there is no sin. And if you can get past it rather than trying to adjudicate it or value it or judge it, just get all the way beyond it, you'll know a freedom and an unconditional love that simply says yes to all things.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Deborah?
Yes, John Mark. Picking up from the previous topic or that conversation that you were having. And so what is the block then to claiming what we, you know, who and what we really are? For me, it's perhaps it's a continuing struggle with worthiness of that love that exists there. I mean it seems to keep, you know, I mean there's certainly an existence in which it exists, and then something might arise and then I'm kind of thrown off of it, and then I feel like it's a, you know, I get you. I guess it's self judgment in the sense that, well, perhaps I'm not worthy of God's love, or being a child of God, or being of, you know, a facet of that diamond. And I don't know if you can speak a little bit more to that.
I'd be happy to, because who here on the screen cannot deeply relate to Deborah's question? Every one of us can relate to this. So great question, my friend. Well, let's talk about in finiteness, in the earth, in the illusion, we associate worth with our behavior.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's the primary underpinning thing, right? I have to behave in a certain way to remain worthy or be worthy. And if I don't, then it's not going well. We would all agree that that's the thing.
Yes.
So we think worthiness is I would do the things that God would have me do. So it's really a behavioral matrix. And just as an aside, if you want to do an interesting little self-looking within your thing, if you look back through human history, clearly there is no universal standard about what's right, about what's acceptable. I mean, it was acceptable at many times in Earth's history to have slaves. Now, of course, we would say that behavior is totally unacceptable, right? So were people back then in a culture where it was accepted that apparently it was okay? So trying to follow the bouncing, mysterious ball of behavioral morality through human history is a futile exercise. So rather than looking at worth as a means of behavior, I'd like to invite you to consider the following. Deborah, are you aware that you exist?
Yes.
Is everyone here aware that you exist? Is anybody in real, real doubt about the fact that you exist? Okay. And in association with the fact that you exist, is it also true that you have the power to choose?
Yes.
Okay. And Deborah, would it also be safe to say that you've used that power to choose and you've made some really bad, bad choices, and you've made some really most excellent choices?
Absolutely.
Okay. And would it also be true that because you exist and you have the power of free will to choose, that you also have this mysterious ability to experience the effects of your choices?
Yes.
Does anybody here know how we actually experience? I mean, how does that happen? Did anybody go to school and take, you know, college 101 how to experience?
No.
Does anybody pray every day, please don't let me lose the ability to experience?
No.
No, it's, this is so intrinsic and so fundamental and so basic. What if, my friend, rather than being associated to your behaviors, God's love is the fact that you do exist, you have always existed, you will always exist. You have an unlimited free will power to choose no matter how you use it. And you have this miraculous and incredible experience, ability to experience your choices. And those can never change. You can never lose those. I mean, if we could lose the power to choose because we made bad choices, who here would not have already lost it? So, Deborah, what if you set yourself free from behavioral matrix and all of its subtleties and craziness to simply God's love is my existence, my ability to choose and create, and my ability to experience, and that is invulnerable, and I don't have to pray for them, I don't have to do anything to get them, and I can never lose them. Is that not unconditional?
Yes.
And within those three things, is that not utter freedom?
Yes.
So worth really has nothing to do with it. That is all a finite distortion of this simple truth. I exist, I have free will choice, and I will always be able to experience those things.
You know, it's what came up as you were talking too, in terms of when I mentioned worthiness. I mean, there's also this, I mean, the self-belief that I've held around this idea of love, and of course it's human love, associated with my, you know, my family, is this notion that I have to earn it. So yeah. Back to the behavioral, you know, lens in which I'm viewing the world, like I have to actually do something to have it.
Okay. That's right. A really great question. Has anybody else felt that same way? All right. Well, let's remember Jesus said, become as a little child. Well, let's look at an infant, fresh born, still damp. Right? That does that child know that it exists?
Yeah. Well,
it's clearly aware and it's interacting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And sometimes it cries and sometimes it smiles. Mm-hmm. That would be the exercising of will. Yeah. Of choice. Mm-hmm. Not mentally, not the way we think of it. And it clearly has the ability to experience.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So though there's God's love, and that kid needed to do nothing to earn it.
Yes.
I mean, this is why nobody teaches you the fact that you exist or that you have free will or that you have this mysterious ability, because it's so intrinsic. Everybody's got it. Everybody's got God's love. I mean, that is a creator. God exists, God creates, God experiences, just like you and me. So if we set ourselves free from the whole unworthiness of behavior, and we set ourselves unworthiness from needing to earn it, because we simply recognize, oh my God, I've got it. I've always had it. And so does everybody else. Even the people who use it in ways that I would never wish to, they're unconditionally loved by God. They're creating and experiencing, and they can't ever stop. So for me, it was that simple recognition that set me free from needing to earn it.
Okay.
Now, what it freed me into was the ability to use it much more productively, sure. Much more joyously, much more in ways that I would prefer. It became a very powerful means of empowerment. Mm-hmm. So love, if you set yourself free from love is the effect of what I do, it can be given or lost, and you come to the realization of what I call the Holy Trinity, I exist, I have the power of free will, and I have the power to experience. That's already yours, and it will always be yours. And it is always perfect. It is always working. That's God's unconditional love. And that is far, far transcendent than human love. And you can look in your own experience and see that it was never taken away. You didn't get more power to choose because you were good, and you didn't lose your power to choose because you did bad things. Mm-hmm. So it's an opportunity to set oneself free from the earthly love and the earthly earning or learning and resting in what's already yours and has always been yours. This is in part why awakening is called realization, not learning something new. Mm-hmm. We're realizing what's always been there.
Thank you.
Good questions, Deborah. Very good questions. Oh. So since nobody else has their hand up, one of the other things that occurred to me today go ahead, Laura.
Okay, so John Mark, one of your things in your triptych is experience. We're free to experience. And yet, oftentimes, I see it in myself and in others that we want to experience and we translate that into feeling. I want to feel that love, and I don't feel it, you know, and so that then turns around into something akin to, okay, I need to go back. If I choose to learn something else, if I choose a different practice, will I then experience this love, this unconditional love? Do you get the gist of what I'm
I do get the gist of it, and I bet everyone here can agree that they too have wondered these things and pondered these things. So we all experience temporary things in the earth, things that come and go, right? Everything in the earth, our bodies come, they're gonna go. The weather comes, the weather goes. A breath comes, a breath goes. A day comes, a day goes. Everything is temporary, has a beginning and an end. Yeah. Just like experiences where we have felt loved have beginnings and ends. So the challenge that you're pointing to is we continue to look for the eternal in the temporary and then decree, because it's not in the temporary the way we think it should be, it's not there. And then we back down and say, well, if it's not there, then I must have done something wrong. I may need to do something more. Again, in the temporary, get you on the hamster wheel, going and going and going and going and going, to try and be good enough or earn enough or learn enough to then get that feeling. But if you're chasing any temporary feeling, then know that it will have a beginning and it will have an end. But what I describe as the Trinity has no beginning and it has no end. So rather than looking for a feeling of unconditional love rooted in your limited human experience of feelings, rather than the ability to feel, because that is eternal. But here comes the kicker. When you truly stop looking for something in the temporary and then dismissing the eternal because it's not showing up in the temporary the way you think it should be, when you really begin to claim what I'm sharing here, what is always eternal, you awaken to that, you claim that, ironically, you will then begin to realize, and this is what the Gospel of Thomas, and he says, at first you'll look within and be deeply disturbed. How many of us know that perfectly? You start to look within, it's deeply disturbing. And then he says, you're going to be amazed, right? Because you're going to begin to discover what's all there, and you're going to grow, you're going to learn, you're going to awaken. And then his third thing is you're going to rule over the universe. And that doesn't mean you sit on a throne and you make all the planets spin around. It means you are the authority of you, the universe, your uniqueness. And as you begin to claim and understand the mighty power in this Trinity that I call, you will begin then to realize that you can manifest through the exercising of your free will the feelings that you feel. And let me give you a little example. So most of us have spent our life, you made me feel, right? We take cues from what happens outside of us, and then we have an unconscious physical, emotional response to that, and we think the cause of our state of being is outside of us, right? Everybody's familiar with this. And if you're really good at this, you start trying to manipulate the world and manipulate others to get more of the feelings that you want, those loving feelings, those happy feelings, right? And we've all understand the complete futility of that. It just never really works. It might work for a little while, but then the person you're playing the game with will secretly change the rules on you. And you're like, what the hell happened? Right? So to your point, Laura, when you begin to really claim this eternal power, which is your spirit, I mean, rather than my spirit being a collection of temporary things and details, my spirit and your spirit and everyone's spirit is the inexhaustible, indestructible qualities, the ability to create. So when I began to set myself free from my emotional response being the effects of what's outside of me and began to claim, wait a minute, if I have this power, if this is part of my existence, this mighty power, what if I could create the emotional states that I would prefer for myself at will, completely free of anyone or anything? And I began to explore, what would it feel like to choose to feel happy? And I began to realize I could alter my state of being at will. Now, I want to be really clear. It wasn't just, can I feel happy? It was, can I manifest consciously through will feeling sad? Can I feel ecstatic? Can I feel loathing? Because what I was discovering was my freedom across the entire emotional range to create my state of being the way I would have it be. And as you know, in the way of Master Yeshua is really clear, I have the freedom to create my experience as I would have it be for me, right? And he demonstrated a magnificent example of being in a really, having a really bad last week of his life, but manifesting an expression that was one of love, that expressed forgiveness and all kinds of wonderful things. Now, luckily, none of us have to go to that whole crucifixion stage. But the point is, if we wake up from looking for a feeling and trying to manifest that feeling through the temporary, claim the eternal, and begin to manifest our creative powers, you may be amazed, as the Gospel of Thomas suggests, that you can rule over your universe and that your emotional state can be at your will, not at the discretion of anyone or anything. And if you want to talk about freedom, that is a powerful, powerful expression of freedom.
Thank you.
Anytime you're looking for a temporary thing to prove your eternal nature, you're just looking in the wrong place. This is what he meant in the Course when he said you'll seek and never find, because you can't find it but it is in the eternal, and then you can express it however you wish.
I mean, and a secondary part of this question is in terms of thinking about awakening or the experience of enlightenment, or because all of us have had moments, and some of us have had longer sections of feeling an awakening experience. But is that also as well something that it can be chosen in the moment? And if I just say, okay, I choose to be enlightened now. That's not going to necessarily happen.
Well, there's a big difference between saying the words in your mind and actually creating an experience. So I know there are lots of us who have said these things in our mind in words over and over and over and over and over, but almost in every saying of the words, we're actually denying the power to create the experience for ourselves. So your point is a valid one, and it's one everyone here can relate to, and it seems like it has just totally left my mind. So could you say the last thing again? Because I got distracted by Daphne writing in the chat because she's got a question. But I'll get to you, Daphne. Can I choose okay. enlightenment? Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I get your point. Well, if enlightenment was Russian roulette in the cosmos, why would there be any teachings that attempt to empower us to awaken and remember who we are? I mean, if it was just a random roll of God's dice, why would there be any teachings encouraging us to awaken and become empowered and claim our creative authority? And likewise, by the way, for all of those who have been taught that death sets us free, if that was the legitimate way, every spiritual path would be how to commit suicide. And that's not there either. So if we take total randomness, because if it's that random, then why did God pick that schmuck and not me, right? And if it's death sets us free, then every true teaching would be how-tos. So every choice that we make, the experience that comes is related to the power with which we believe we make the choice. And how many of us have felt like the power to choose in us is not very powerful, right? I'm choosing, and nothing's happening. Or does it seem to be happening? Well, this is why Jesus would say, do you believe? And by that, what he was meaning was, are you claiming that you are as a creator and that your choices are powerful and that cause your choice, and I don't just mean words in your mind, and your experience should begin to line up. They should be one, right? And in I know you love the Course in Miracles. He says cause and effect are one. Right? In truth, most of us experience choice and experience being vastly distant things with a lot of seeming randomness in between. So awakening can be very gentle and smooth for most. It can be like a one of those heart EKGs. It can be up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down. All of us get, by grace, looks. We all, by grace, get almost a preview of things to come. But in those looks, and I know you've had some of these enlightening experiences, when those things begin to fade, what separates us from living in that state and where we are is what we need to let go of to get to that level of being and anchor there, remain there, right? We can't keep our self-judgment and enjoy states of enlightenment, right? So by grace, we get looks, we get experiences that encourage us on the path. That's God's rushing to greet you in the whole parable, the prodigal son story. So if we move towards those experiences and then are willing to live in and as them, not make them a memory of some enlightened experience I had in the past and now I'm back to my normal self, we actually choose by the power of our free will to release things and move towards the anchored lived experience of those states of being. And these acts of grace that kind of show us coming attractions of ever greater awakening are really incredible gifts of grace, because they always are inviting us into greater and greater and greater and greater realization, greater and greater self-empowerment, greater and greater creativity. Makes sense? So no experience comes unchosen, even if it's, I mean, just by getting on a spiritual journey of any kind with any pathway, you're really saying, hey, I want to wake up. I may not understand it yet. I may not understand the concepts or the beliefs. I may not have a lot of faith, but I'm willing. I mean, I'm trying. I'm starting. So those things start coming to encourage us to continue the journey. So every one of those, and I know people, you and I have talked about having an experience and then losing it. It's like, what did I do wrong? Why was it taken away? What the fuck, right? But those are really invitations. And if we realize the invitation, and while that experience is still really fresh, if you realize, wait a minute, what if I could recreate that experience through the power of my choice and free will? What if I learn to live in that state of being and let go any beliefs that I have to the contrary? And you see how that encourages God, you know, constantly encouraging us, mm-hmm. welcoming us to awaken more and more and more. So throw out the death thing as a means of freedom, because that's a way that mass mind tries to get you to not claim this level of authority and empowerment and awaken in life. Throw out the whole thing if it's just random dice, because there's probably nothing less empowering than that belief. Let those things go and continue to claim, to beat the band. And when you claim, I don't just mean saying words in your mind louder. I mean actually exercising the creative power that you have and getting really curious about it and really explore it. And there are lots of very simple ways to do that that are not heavy spiritual practices, that don't require rigidity or schedule or anything else. It can be quite delightful and a lot of fun. So I hope some of that helps.
Thank you. Thank you for the reminders.
Hey, Daphne, how you doing? It's good to have you back. What do you want to ask? You'll need to unmute. Yeah, you're still muted, my friend.
There we go.
There you go.
I was tapping on the wrong little icon thing. Well, I have three questions, but they're all related basically to the same thing. And it's like, I really appreciate your teachings about, you know, of that we all exist, that we have the ability to experience, and we have the power to choose. But still, I keep coming up with some really basic stuff that's at the beginning, and I don't know why I get tripped up with it. But it's kind of like, well, when I'm not having a good part of the dream, as it were, this lifetime, why do we even need to dream up a lifetime at all? If we've been doing this for so long, and I've, you know, by rights, I get the impression as though I've done it all, then why would I even bother choosing to do it again? So then the next question behind that is, if like for being a creator, but if everything was already created in a way, and I don't mean by form, but it seems like, would there really, the whole concept of new, does it really exist? And the other thing is, do we need to have a dream life in order to, quote, wake up?
Okay. Which one would you like to start with first?
The first one, about why dream a lifetime at all.
Okay. Let's be really clear. There is Zippo requirement to incarnate. It is not a mandate. It is not a requirement. Not at all. And there are, and in the Lama Singh work, there's a very beautiful distinction between those who incarnate and those mm-hmm. who choose not to. Angels are those souls who have chosen never to incarnate.
Never to. Yeah.
Never to incarnate. There's Zippo requirement. You know, Jesus tried to talk about that, you know, his beautiful prodigal son story reflects both of these. There were two sons. One chose to incarnate, right? Chose to forget, enter the dream, be a body, the whole bit. And one chose not to.
Okay. Right.
Right. Because yes, that's the exercise in a free will. So no requirement, Zippo requirement. And for those of you who may have taken on some of the mass mind beliefs that you have to incarnate like 100,000 times before you can be free,
right,
recognize that that belief is what will encourage your next incarnation.
Understood.
Yeah. So recognize that there is no requirement unless you self-impose that requirement.
Right. Understood.
And a soul may self-impose that requirement for innumerable free reasons.
Right.
It might, you might have had experience, almost like a menu. Well, I haven't experienced this culture. I wonder what that would be like from just simple, wondrous curiosity, right?
Okay.
And another soul might choose because they're still holding ideas of sin that they may need to reincarnate to try and work off some of that sin, right?
Do-overs.
Whatever. So there is Zippo requirement, never requirement from any child of God to incarnate. My gosh, if you leave this life with one realization, please let it be that.
Okay.
That incarnation is a choice, a sovereign choice, and you are never required to do it.
Okay.
Having said that, if you are beginning to realize your creative nature, and you might like to explore like an artist would. There's no requirement for me to paint on this canvas.
Right.
There's no requirement at all. But I might discover that I enjoy painting. And I might want to paint with this technique. And I might want to paint with that technique. And I might want to explore other artistic means of expression. Right.
Yeah.
So that can be a very reasonable and legitimate way that some souls choose to incarnate.
Okay.
I was having dinner with Cindy's mother one time, and she was pretty much asking the same thing. Why?
Right. Yeah.
And it's a very popular question. Every one of us have asked this question, why? And I knew in that moment that there was
the whole purpose of why are we here?
Yeah, that there was one way for her to understand. Because she loves to cook. And I said, that's like asking, why are there a bunch of recipes? And as soon as she realized, what I was suggesting to her was that life is the freedom to explore lots of things, like she likes to explore lots of recipes.
Right. Okay.
She understood it. And she began to have a different relationship to the creative potential, which a lifetime represents. So no requirement, all kinds of free will choices, why a soul may choose or not choose to incarnate based on that soul's level of awareness.
Right.
I mean, most of us here are coming like you to been there, done that. I've got the t-shirt and the Akashic record represent a whole lot of stuff in finiteness.
Right.
And what if at the stage of asking, why would I want to do this anymore, is the very threshold of the doorway to your freedom that you never have to do it again.
Okay.
You can ask the why question and look back, or you can be really clear. I am clear. I feel complete in the earth. I don't feel the need to learn anything else. I don't feel the need to change anything else. I don't feel the need. What if that represents, oh my God. And I know some of you have talked about kind of losing the zest for life.
Right.
And it almost feels a little depressive because everything all of a sudden seems bland.
Yeah.
Well, what if that is your soul actually going, thank God I'm free. I'm done.
Okay.
I'm complete.
Yeah.
And what if you were to cultivate that freedom?
Right.
That I don't have to return by virtue of asking, knowing I've done it all. Maybe that's the, I finally realized I got nothing else to learn in finiteness. I don't need to take on any more bodies. I don't need to suffer anymore.
Thank you.
That's a very empowering way to live the rest of your life. Yeah, it is. I can feel it.
Yeah,
of course you can.
So then behind that, do we need to be in a lifetime in order to wake up?
Of course not. But if you can awaken in the very realm where everything is suggesting the opposite, please realize the power that you will gain in that, and that never again could you be deceived by illusion. I mean, if you can wake up on the one stage which is designed to keep everyone asleep,
right,
recognize the creative power recognized within your soul and spirit by that very action. And having done so, and all of us, I mean, come on, let's not say awakening is one fine line.
Right. Yeah.
All of us are awakening. All of us are awake in many, many ways.
Yes.
So back to the prodigal son story to wrap this up. When the son returns and when the prodigal son returns and is given the ring and the robe and the whole thing, right? Like big, we're going to have a big feast to celebrate.
Right.
And the other spirits kind of like, well, why all this celebration for him?
Right.
And God said, this was my son who went out to create, to discover, to exercise the very power and freedom with which I gave him. And he has returned with the wisdom and the power that he has realized from those creations. Does that make him better than the angel who never incarnated? No, but it certainly makes them distinct. It certainly makes them unique because they...
But then why wouldn't the other son, as in the brother, why wouldn't he also incorporate exactly what, you know,
why wouldn't they choose to incarnate? Sure.
No. Why wouldn't he incorporate what the other brother learned by going out and having experience? But is it the experiencing that makes it different?
Well,
you know what I'm asking?
Things. Yeah, I think you're asking why wouldn't the other soul or spirit incarnate to begin exploring that level of creation?
No. Okay. If by my living my lifetime, and because there are no private thoughts, right? Now, granted, I will have the experiences by living my life, but when it's all said and done and I transition or whatever, maybe you don't need to transition in order to make it be transferred. That same knowledge of experience, wouldn't that transfer to all my brothers and sisters?
Of course, your experiences are, and that's what's in your Akashic record. It's not facts and figures. It's really the sum total of your experiences.
Right. Those
can be, through mutual agreement, available to any other soul to experience them in the exact same way that you did. So you could experience a whole lot of things vicariously, really, without ever incarnating. Yes, that's absolutely possible. There's a beautiful reading where Al, in one of his journeys, Susan's husband, who was the channeler for Lama Singh, he's out in the consciousness and he comes upon a child of God and he's like asking that child of God, don't you want to come into the earth and smell the roses? And the child of God's like, nope, no thanks, nope.
Right.
So underneath your why, and I can feel that, and we all can appreciate that's behind that why. really let that soften. Why does I choose a hamburger on the menu? Why does somebody else choose a Caesar salad? Maybe we just celebrate that we're each free to choose and we don't have to get a why behind it.
Yes.
Why infers there's a right way.
Well, for a long time, I really relaxed the whole why thing. I mean, for years, but then ever since, you know, health wise, that I came into this whole big realm of pain thing, it just, I felt like I just really went back to the basics. You know, it just kind of turned everything upside down again. Really, you know, I could feel all the whys come right back up, like like I all of a sudden it felt like I hardly learned anything, although I know that's not true. I've incorporated so much of, you know, I've been studying the course for a long time, but it's not just the course, you know, it's whatever non-dual. But I just wow, I just somehow this, the ending of this particular lifetime turned out to be a lot tougher than I thought it was going to be. And I, in a lot of ways, I have just been struggling to see a lot of my options, I guess. So it came, now all these whys are kind of back in a vengeance.
Sure. Yeah. Well, pain particularly can be a really acute because it gets your damn attention and
right,
it won't
exactly.
let go of your attention.
Yeah, so, and it's body centered.
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course. Well, it can be, we can hurt mentally in ways too, but
that's true.
To your point, we all have a choice of how to be in relationship with pain. And we can be in an opposing relationship with it and
okay.
why. Or we can use it as an opportunity to say, something is here. What if I use this as a reminder to claim my divinity? What if I use this as an ability to remember I'm one with God and I'm greater than this?
Right. I've seen that too, but I don't have the answer coming yet.
Well, maybe there's not an answer. Maybe the fact that it's there, it is an opportunity. What will you do with it?
Okay.
I mean, what will you do with that opportunity? And I'm not saying it's a welcome opportunity. I'm not saying we all want it. We
right.
don't. But
right.
it comes. I've
yeah.
been in, you know, I pulled a muscle not all that long ago. I know some others have had pain and discomfort. I, too, have been in the opposing it, pushing against it kind of thing. There was
right.
actually Susan recently who helped me grok the opportunity that it presents to claim and be in communion in our oneness.
Okay.
And
because yeah.
obviously Jesus was in an awful lot of pain, at least his
right.
physical body
right.
wasn't.
That's
in.
What I keep coming
but
back to too.
He didn't lose his connection, right?
Right. Yes.
And
exactly.
So what if the pain is an opportunity for us to each claim greater mastery?
Yeah.
Because it's one thing to know you're free.
Right.
And it's another thing to know you're free in the face of that which seeks to limit your freedom.
Right.
In the face of challenge, if you will. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not advocating, hey, I'm done with challenge. I've had all of it I need. I'm not saying bring on more challenge. But if it comes,
yeah, right.
I recognize that it represents an opportunity.
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
So rather than looking at it like I've done something wrong or why is this happening to me, that
right.
whole victimhood story.
Because I know that's not true. And I know when I go there, it's just another ego trap. But it's somehow that really dovetailed really well with the whole business of why bother with this dream at all. And I don't know how to explain it well in words, but your answers were just really helpful. Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, we've been at it an hour, and I feel like I've monopolized all the time. Would anyone else like to share anything? Gabby?
I just wanted to say how absolutely fabulous and wonderful this has been. I just enjoyed it so much, and I want to say, let's do it every night. I'm just kidding, but it was really, really awesome. Thank you. Thank you,
You're
everyone.
Welcome.
Great questions.
That's really beautiful, Gabby. Thank you. The intention that Susan and I have with this is that all of this that we do together would empower you and set you free. Not burden you with more stuff to do, not burden you with anything, but that you would be freed as a result of this communion, and that you would be empowered, because so much of spirituality seems to be disempowering, not empowering. Thank goodness for that. So, Susan, would you want to send us out with a little prayer?
Sure. As we close our eyes and breathe in and breathe out, we breathe in the communion that is ever a part of us, ever one with us, and the communion of all of these who are gathered in the physical, all those who walk with us unseen, and all those who have gone before to help open this path of realization and experiencing of utter freedom. And this we hold in our hearts as we move through this week and in coming times. Thank you. Thank you all. So be it.
Thank you, Susan. Play well, friends.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Aloha.
Aloha.